I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night.
I have come to the conclusion that daylight and sunlight are two different lights. Just as the Bible says, sunlight being the light we see when we look at the sun, a yellowish white light that is direct light, a line of sight light, the cause of shadows. The second light is daylight, which is a diffused light, a glowing, scattered light with limited range, which consists of many visible different colors. Once you get above the ozone layer, 12 to 18 miles up, the invert gases will separate according to the atomic weight. Helium, neon, and argon all rise above the ozone layer and layer out themselves. Now the diffused light, which you see here, comes from these layers of invert gases that separate in the perfect calm and absolute cold once high enough. And the electromagnetic field of the close passing sun is exciting these inert gases. And these gases, when excited, emit photons, which you know is light. Now, if you change the voltage, temperature, or the pressure, or its elemental neighbor, and you change the color and intensity of the diffused light. Now let's focus on electricity and argon. Argon and neon are the third and fifth most abundant element in the composition of air. There is more argon than neon, and there is more neon than ozone, methane, and carbon monoxide combined. Now all of the colors that you see here can be produced with just neon. A full spectrum of light with all the noble gases. Now the shadow here is actually a convergent line, and then under that you have the edge of the electromagnetic field and then the edge of daylight. Now I also don't believe that daylight is a perfect circle surrounding the sun either. Because daylight will take the shape of the electric and magnetic fields that it is within. Now notice also here the sun disappears into the horizon, not below it. Now this is because of perspective, and the daylight eventually drowns out the sunlight. You are looking lengthwise through the layers of photons. And this explains the colors, the layers, the range, the abrupt termination lines, receding light, and so much more. All you need are noble gases and an electric current. Now, those of you who think you see a curved earth here, the curve you observe here is the light, not the earth. That's right, yes, I said the light is curved, not the earth. Now, the reason the light curves is because the field curves, which is what I'm fixing to demonstrate for you here. Now, for those of you who don't know, another property of ionized gas is a magnetic field, which means the electromagnetic field of the sun is pulling on the field of the earth as it passes. And the magnetic field also increases the brightness when interacting with the ionized field. Now, the light is transparent, but when you concentrate and intensify the discharge of photons, it becomes impossible to see through. Now, let me show you how to light up noble gases with a Tesla coil. I want you to pay attention to the colors here, especially the neon. Okay, the first and second glass tube are helium and neon, which will emit a constant sky blue light when placed within the field. Now Now, neon will also emit red and yellow photons as well. The sky looks blue because it is blue. The photons are a specific frequency our eyes interpret as blue. So you have helium, neon, argon, krypton, and xenon. These are the noble gases that make up 1% of the air. So as you see, the sun creates the field, and the noble gases within this field create the light. You could say the sun governs the light, in other words. Now, as you can see here, the daylight and sunrise and sunset colors of neon, which is your sky blues, your yellows, and reds. Remember that, everyone. Sky blue, yellow, and reds. Look for them the next time you watch the sunset. Now, the moon is also made up of these noble gases. As you can see right here, the moon is transparent, which explains why you can see through one side of it, as you see here. Remembering what I taught you before, the electromagnetic field of the sun is pulling on the fields of the earth as it passes over the earth, just as it pulls on the magnetic field of the moon as it passes it. Just like the earth's light is transparent, but when you concentrate and intensify the discharge of photons, it becomes impossible to see through. As you can see here, the sun on one side of the moon is intensifying the discharge of photons, but you've been taught that it's reflecting the sun's light. But it's the electromagnetic field of the sun lighting up the photons being discharged from the moon gases, making it impossible to see through like you can on the right side of it. And therefore, now you know how you get your moon phases. As you can see here, the sun is making its circuit around the right side of the moon now, and then it's eventually going to be in front of it. Now, when it's directly in front of it, that's when you have your full moon. And as it works its way around its circuit, it will be passing on the left side of the moon, which will give you your third and fourth phase of the moon. So just like the gases in the sky, or just like the gases in the moon, you can't see them until the sun intensifies them and discharges their photons. Which means Professor Armand R. Foster was right when he stated that the moon was made of plasma in 1965.
Questions related to thoughts of genius. Do you think or consider yourself to be a genius?
No. I consider myself to be an ordinary, humble person who wants to serve mankind with what man has striven for from the beginning of consciousness, with truth and understanding of the world.
Well, now, one thing, you have a theory about the moon, and we expect to be able to get observable facts about the moon fairly soon. What is your theory?
Well, it is by now rather more than a theory. 10 or 11 years ago, I stated to various scientists that the moon is not a piece of rock, but it is a plasma phenomenon, a cosmic plasma, and that this fact will eventually be confirmed. I made certain predictions which were already confirmed in 1958, and the situation now is coming close to a complete confirmation.
What will be the result if you are proved to be correct in your theories?
The result will be profound and decisive, because it will give proof that a complete reinvestigation of the laws of nature is necessary. Because if the moon is a plasma, no man will ever land on it. The soft landing attempts will all fail. That means that the mass of the moon is less, far less, than is currently assumed. It's in a different state of energy, and it has far less mass. That means there is no more explanation for the tides. If the moon, for example, had only a thousandth part of its current mass, then the tides would only be 2 inches high, and the conventional theories instead of sometimes 14 feet. And that means that if it is proved that the moon is a plasma, then all gravitational theories are out, and a new concept of the cosmos and of its laws has to be evolved. But the moon is definitely, as I assert, a plasma, this crisis. So it comes again to the age-old concept that truth is the guidance, the hope, and the directive of the human mind, and that man must strive to understand and to know the real nature of the world.
Plasma, an ionized gas consisting of positive ions and free electrons in proportions resulting in more or less no overall electric charge. So, as you can see, like I said, the professor was right. But I think it's awful funny that 4 years later, they supposedly land on the moon and all of his work just disappeared, as you can see here.
As reported by ABC, in 1965, this scientist tried to turn conventional science on its head. Among R. Foster's theories was that the moon was in fact made of plasma, not rock, and that landing on it would not be possible. Mr. Foster claimed that once his profound and decisive investigations were proven, a complete reinvestigation of the laws of nature would be necessary. The ABC has been unable to confirm Mr. Foster's identity beyond the entry in the production notebook from 1965. Which is what I just showed you. We have also been unable to find any documentation of his work. So, of course not, because that was 1965, 4 years before they were going to fake this moon landing. So they just made his work and him totally disappear. But back to the subject at hand, now you know how sunlight, daylight, and the moon phases work. Everyone, thanks for watching. Have a good night, and God bless.
All I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.